I listened to your talk on YouTube. I think you are talking Ayurveda in a different language.
I've read only one Veda, sir, that is this one.
Inner exploration is very important. That is the place where Ayurveda is born. Mm.
Namaskaram, all of you.
Namaskaram.
Everybody looks like a bank robber. I don't know who.
So the Ayur Prana is doing great work in the field of Ayurveda. They create Ayurvedic herbal product. We bring raw material from India, organically grown, no chemical pesticides, no chemical fertilizer. Then we test it here, see that there are no toxic heavy metals, arsenic, mercury, lead. And such a good work. They create churna, which is powder form, siddha tailam, medicated oil, siddha ghritam, medicated ghee, gutika, vatika, tablet. And boy, this Benny and Botanical and Ayur Prana, they are doing very good work in the field of Ayurveda. Mm-hmm. And so that Ayurveda is becoming quite popular in the Western world, both in America, England, Germany. An amazing thing, there is so much hunger for Ayurvedic clinical approach. So I teach them Nadi Pariksha. And in Nadi Pariksha, the basic Manduka Gati, Sarpa Gati, Lavaka Gati, Tittira Gati, Hamsa Gati, different Gatis are there. And with the grace of God, I am a good artist. I draw the picture of the pulse, how it looks. Mm-hmm. And we are doing webinars. And each Friday, some new subject, new topic, that how to determine Prakruti through the pulse, how to do the assessment of Vikruti, the present altered status of the dosha. Then through the pulse, we can understand the Manas Prakruti, Manas Vikruti, sub doshas, Pran, Vyan, Udan, Saman, all these sub doshas. And boy, there is so much demand. People love that. And to teach this subject in Zooming or on Zooming is quite an art. We have 2-3 cameras where I go near the camera and I just say, this is Vata Pigam, Adya Madhya Antyanadi. Adyanadi, Vata, Madhyanadi, Pitta, Antyanadi, Kapha. And then slowly the spike under each finger, Vata Pitta Kapha, Vata Pitta Kapha. And when we go deep, Niguda Nadi, Prakruti Pradarshini, Uttanatu Vikruta. So Muncha Muncha Dhrutva Dhrutva, hold it, leave it, and then you will come to that state, that spike. And you have to just pay attention to the kapha spike, pitta spike, vata spike. Under this 3 finger, how many vata spike, how many pitta spike you get, and based upon that you can determine your prakruti. The deep level, the 7th level is prakruti, and prakruti is your unique genetic code. It is your blueprint. It is still there, pulsating, throbbing under your radial artery. And amazing, people love it. So this work, Ayur Prana, is doing quite a fantastic work in the field of Ayurveda. Mm-hmm. And a couple of years ago, I was in Coimbatore also. Dr. Krishna Kumarji and Ram Kumar, they invited me to teach Ayurvedic art of... This is a lost art. No school teaches this ancient Vedic art of pulse assessment. And Krishna Kumarji, he loved it. He's such a holy person. And they have a big school there in Vaidya Graman, and they do Panchakarma there. And there were about 200 Ayurvedic doctors. They come there to receive this art of reading the pulse. It is art, but it is a science. And in Ayurveda, science and art can go together.
It is just that everything is put through the same microscope today.
Correct.
So if you say, I love somebody, they will check your blood and prove to you that you don't.
Correct.
So, all the subtler aspects of life, well, see, the grosser aspects of life manifest strongly. Studying them is one way. The subtler aspects of life, their manifestation is subtle.
Yeah, absolutely.
So for everything, if you say, show me where it is, you cannot… I cannot even show you the air that you breathe.
Correct.
Nobody can prove that you're alive, actually. There is no proof that there is life here. The heart is beating, but time will come when they will make the dead body's heart beat. It's not far away, I'm saying. They can pump the blood, they can make it work. So, there is no proof that we are alive either. So, in a way, this for everything gross physical proof will lead to a point where it's already happening, where life is not valuable, only the structures that we build is valuable. The fundamental life itself is not valuable. We are forgetting everything else that we built, the house that we built is only an accessory to our life. The clothes that we wear is only an accessory to our life.
Correct.
But these things have become bigger than life itself.
Absolutely.
That's the… So in a culture and atmosphere like that right now, it needs to get to its peak and go down.
Absolutely.
Till then, it's hard to convince people about the subtler dimensions. Beginning to happen, but still it's not mainstream.
That's beautiful.
This is so with Ayurveda, this is so with almost every aspect.
Every aspect, right.
And also there is a, you know, like we've been running a small manufacturing unit on an experimental level and also producing something to keep it going. So our work has been last 25 years to bring batch integrity to Ayurvedic medicine. It's simply not possible because the leaf that's plucked in the morning and in the afternoon it's different, seasons are different. We found the batch variations, the efficacy variations are up to 80%.
Yeah.
And if you take any of the top manufacturers, even there it is so. But today people are asking for batch integrity like a chemical process where every batch can be the same in a pharmaceutical. In Ayurveda and Siddha, it depends on the season, it depends on the rainfall, it depends on the sunlight, it depends whether you, you know, did the grinding in the morning or evening.
Yeah.
You can't do it whichever way you like. So, we are doing something very small, very, very small, but super effective. But when we try to expand it, it loses its thing. So we kept it very, very small. Now there is work going on to build a 1200-bed integrated hospital, which has both allopathy and this, because otherwise I find… see, today a whole lot of things are because of… proximity of living populations in cities. Most people, as they're suffering chronic ailments, along with that they have parallel infectious issues. If they are not dealt with, Ayurveda can deal with chronic aspects, something that happens within the body. But where, you know, an external invasion has happened, you need some chemical warfare.
Correct, correct, of course.
So trying to bring this thing, we are calling this as integrated health solutions, where Siddha, Ayurveda, allopathy, Unani and naturopathy and yoga all mixed together according to each person, mixing it in the right context. It works well, but at the same time, today we expect everything to become like a concrete science. This is it, this is it. It doesn't work like that. You have to observe, you have to… You cannot get… You know, right now we are working towards that we can get treated on the Zoom or we can get treated by a phone.
Correct.
You know, all diagnosis will be done by your phone after some time, that's where we're going. That will not be possible because this needs a certain level of observation. Each person responds to these things differently. Above all, it takes involvement. Whether health or well-being or spirituality needs involvement. Right now, we are trying to do everything without involvement.
Correct.
Simply, just like that. Everything systemic, no involvement. Well, all the subtler, more tender aspects of life, beautiful aspects of life will disappear if there is no involvement.
Yeah.
Everything is systemic.
Absolutely, yeah. That's why this is moving towards integral approach, integrative approach. And even in Arizona, there is a integrated medical schools and they are doing research. So what you say is very true because every science has limitation. Allopathy is very good for acute emergency. But once that emergency is over, then Ayurveda can help to take care of chronic ailment like rheumatoid arthritis or gout or even ascites. In all these disorders, Ayurveda has a good approach. And slowly, slowly, Ayurveda and allopathy can come together. Ayurveda will come to the mainstream, but it will take time.
Yeah, more of a holistic approach is definitely needed. Individual doctors, a few of them are doing it. On the larger level, I don't know where it'll come together because they're moving in divergent ways.
That's also possible.
Because the basic thought process of entirely depending upon technology and everything is kind of an absolute. Well, health is not an absolute thing.
Right.
You may be healthy now, in the next 5 minutes you may not be.
Yeah, it is relative.
it just varies. It's the nature of how life happens. So, these absolute things about you tested my blood in the morning and everything is fine with me, but I may be dead by the evening.
Oh, yeah.
So many people do, I'm saying.
Yeah,
So, this absolutism needs to go and we need to look at life with a more holistic and a more gentler approach, which needs lot of cultivation and new kind of civilization. When I say a new kind of civilization, right now our idea of civilization is that we dominate everybody and we are civilized. No idea of civilization is there is no need to dominate anyone, that is civilization.
That is correct.
But unfortunately, we think the other way around. When Mahatma Gandhi was asked by someone, what do you think about the Western civilization? He said, it's a good idea. It's not me, it's him. Because we are misunderstanding domination as civilization. The fundamental of civilization is there is no need to dominate anyone. It doesn't matter, somebody is weak, somebody is strong, somebody is young, somebody is old, somebody is male, somebody is female. You don't have to dominate anything, even other life around you.
Absolutely.
That's civilization. But right now our idea of civilization is putting a stamp, our stamp on everybody's face. Tell us whatever you can speak about Ayurveda. I'm an ignorant person on this. So,
no, Ayurveda is individual's medicine. Ayurveda treat every individual separately. In modern medicine, they do statistical observation, what is common in 100 people. Based upon that normality, they try to judge the individual. But Ayurveda has a unique approach in the sense, pinde pinde matir bhinnaha, or pinde pinde prakrutir bhinnaha. So, Ayurvedic approach is more prakriti-vikriti paradigm. Perhaps one person will handle aspirin because he is kapha, but pitta person will be very super sensitive to the aspirin, it can create severe reaction. So Ayurveda says that to understand the individual and then treat accordingly based upon his prakriti, vikruti, environment, lifestyle. All these have great significant value. And I listened to your talk on YouTube. I think you are talking Ayurveda in a different language. So if you say, I don't know Ayurveda, that is your greatness, but you are talking great principles of life, which is coming from ancient Vedic wisdom, Rig Veda and Atharva Veda. So Ayurveda is a way of life,
living in harmony. I've read only one Veda, sir, that is this one.
That's correct.
I didn't read anything else. Other four I didn't read because I'm too illiterate for those.
That is Atma Veda. Atma Veda is the mother of all Veda.
So I don't have the burden of four Vedas sitting on my head.
Correct.
I respect them, but I just read this and it's kept me busy.
No, actually, Veda is born in the heart of Rishi, you know. They observed it, they saw it, and they wrote it.
No, that is a thing right now in the world.
Yeah, right.
If you say, if this happens to me all the time, if I say anything, they ask, where is it written?
Right.
Then I say, you write it, man. Because if you have so much value for written word, you write it. So, this whole thing of the so-called educated and scholarship is, if something is valuable, it must be written.
Correct.
Not realizing it was written by some human being out of his realization or observation or whatever he saw right there. So it's not that we don't have respect for the written word, but we must understand that unless in every generation we produce human beings who are beyond the written word, who know from where the written word comes, from what basis, then written word will become very dogmatic and become like a dogmatic religion. People will start enforcing it in a few generations forcefully. Then they will say, you are pitta, so you must be beheaded. I'm saying it'll happen.
Yeah.
For all kinds of things, people have been beheaded, isn't it? For all sorts of
things. All sorts of.
So it's very important that every generation we create people who understand the basis of the written word, not just the written word.
Correct, right.
Students will understand the written word, but there must be somebody who understands the basis of from where the written word comes,
from
what basis. So I think Ayurveda needs to do work on that aspect.
Correct.
From Vaidyas who are invested in it, completely their life was invested in it. Today they're going to college for 4.5 years and becoming Ayurvedic doctors, which I feel is not going to work for this kind of science.
Correct, correct.
This is not that kind of science. This needs self-observation beyond anything. How your own system works. If I don't know how mine works, how do I know how yours work? I'm saying right now, this is our medical sciences, unfortunately. How many doctors are healthy? It's a big question mark.
Correct, right.
So, it's very, very important that there has to be a certain, at least a small percentage of people in every generation who know the basis of the written word. Otherwise, just the written word will create a dogmatic process that it'll no more be a science, it'll become like religion.
Correct, right.
What I say is right. If you don't agree to what I say, you must either die or you must disappear. This has been the approach, unfortunately. So, producing those people like you with experience, in some way you must inspire people not just to become teachers, instructors, practitioners, but to imbibe the fundamentals.
So, that is also basic concept of Ayurveda, to know yourself, what you are. Self-knowing is the foundation of life. If I don't know myself, what is my prakriti, what is my vikruti, how thinking happens, how reaction comes, how emotion takes place, this whole inner inquiry, inner exploration is very important. That is the place where Ayurveda is born.
How will you live long if you don't know how to think and feel?
Absolutely.
People are thinking themselves to death. They're not working themselves to death. Most of them are thinking themselves to death.
Correct. We are really happy in my… I'm from Maharashtra and my mother tongue is Marathi. And in Marathi, there is a saying, Sant eti ghara, tochi diwali ani dasara. Means, when saintly person like you come home, that is really Diwali. And this
Dasara,
is the Diwali,
said,
they have
said
celebrated
Dasara,
Diwali.
Right now it's Dasara only.
Yeah, Dasara. Dasara. Because this Diwali and Dasara, the 10 doors of perception, Pancha Jnanendriya, Pancha Karmendriya, and all these sensory perception, motor action, if we bring harmony in that, it is really that Dasara. And Diwali is the festival of light. And you are the light, and light is within you. So in that way, such a highly enlightened Guruji, Sadguruji is here. So it is truly Diwali and Dasara, because Dasara brings Diwali. So thank you, dear, you have done wonderful thing.
I'm from Mysore. Mm-hmm. I just forgot to bring my elephants. Dasara is a big event in
big
Mysore
event,
city.
Right. Mm-hmm.
You know, it's every year just going and gathering there for the procession and then mm-hmm. so many things happening. I must tell you, right from my childhood I've been to many Dasara processions, always my parents took us when we were very young, later mm-hmm. on we went. Then when I was probably 16, 17, I thought, what is there in that procession, and we get a holiday, we go somewhere else and all that. One Vijayadashmi day, I got involved with a small orphanage where there were about 40, 42 children were there. These kids, if I just go there to play with them something, they would just come and, you know, the way they hug you with the desperation is unbelievable. Then I said, I asked them, Dasara is there, have you seen the procession? None of them had seen.
Mm-hmm.
Some of them were 12 years old, many of them were like 4 or 5 like this. So I decided to take all of them. I hired a
cargo
truck, you know, a small one, small truck like a matador, it used to be called, a little one.
Mm-hmm.
So I borrowed this from my friend and put these children in the back in the cargo deck with an adult and drove it there and found a nice place for them to see. Oh my God, the way they were excited, seeing the Maharaja and the elephant and the mm-hmm. horses and the procession and the tableaus, oh my God, I can never forget that. I just sat there and cried that day. Because these kids, what it meant to them seeing that procession, and that's what it is. And the moment we grow up and the moment we see a few films and some other entertainment, we just forget, you know.
Mm-hmm.
We were also excited when we were kids.
Correct.
But later on you think, what is there to see? I've seen it so many times. But after seeing those children, I thought, if I'm in Mysore, I must go for the procession, it doesn't matter what.
That's great.
Though there is a lot of jostling, pushing, pulling, everything happening.
Even this Navaratri, the 9 days and nights of Durga Ma, and every name has a significant value in Ayurveda. Pratamam Shailaputriti, Dutiyam Brahmacharani, Tritiyam Chandragandeti, Kushman. These are the names of the vanaspati, these are mm-hmm. the names of the herbs. And these 9 herbs, on those particular days when we make a decoction, tea and take it, it will get benefit. So that it will bring clarity, it will bring health and happiness, and amazing, it will balance the 3 doshas, it will burn the ama, the toxic morbid metabolic waste in the body. So, Ayurveda is totally percolated in every so-called ritualistic event.
No, it kind of merged with the culture.
Yeah.
This
yeah,
is the whole thing.
Yeah.
Medicine was not about one doctor knowing
Correct.
About it.
It is a
it's
whole
about
culture
everybody
thing.
Knowing
yeah.
what to do about themselves.
Mm-hmm.
As a part of this, we created herbal gardens in over 123 villages,
mm-hmm.
herbal gardens.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody donated a piece of land and we grow about 108 varieties of herbs,
mm-hmm.
and in that village we teach them how to use it.
How
anybody
use it.
Can go and pluck for their use.
Mm-hmm.
They can't take it in a bag and go, but they can pluck for their use.
Absolutely.
Simple things, children have a stomach ache, they go to the doctor and stand in a queue.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody has a headache, they go there. All these things when we were growing up was just handled at home.
Mm-hmm.
Now for everything there is a consultation, for everything The first of all, going and standing in the clinic like you're already sick.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, your stomach is upset, you're not sick. It's just that, you know, body mm-hmm. wants to mm-hmm. get rid of something. You're not sick. But in today's terms, if you have a little bit of loose stools, you're sick. If you have a little bit of headache, you're sick.
Sick.
So we started this whole thing and still it's going on, I mean the village people are maintaining it. I would like to ask you one question. In the tribal cultures in southern India,
mm-hmm.
plants are identified as masculine and feminine.
Uh-huh.
In Ayurveda, is there such a thing that
there
are feminine herbs and masculine herbs?
It's very simple. It is based upon Shiva Swarodaya. If you take a leaf, there is a central, that is Sushumna. If you hold, because every leaf has a solar side and lunar side. The shiny side is solar, it takes solar energy, and the rough side is lunar. And if you look at the plant, the stem, and then there are horizontal lines. If you count those sira, that is called sira, if it is even number, so it is a female tree. If it is an odd number, it is a male tree. So male-female can be detected through how many horizontal lines are there on the leaf. This is amazing, very fascinating. And rasavire vipak of the plant, rasa is the taste, vire is the energy, heating and cooling, and vipak is the post-digestive effect. And then prabhav, achintya virya prabhav. Prabhav is the action on pilupak and pitarpak. Pilupak is happening at a atomic level to the cell membrane. And pitarpak, pitar means parents, which is a genetic factor. So the herb goes up to the genetic factor and to the RNA, DNA level. So this is very interesting that male plant and female plant we can detect just by looking at this. Shiva Swarodaya is another wonderful science of Surya Swar, Chandra Swar, Ida, Pingala, Sushumna. And even in every plant, there is a Ida, Pingala, Sushumna. So Ayurveda is really talking about male trees, female trees. Now, when I came here in Santa Fe, I was teaching Ayurveda in Santa Fe College of Natural Medicine. And there were so many here Native American herbs. Chamomile, comfrey, angelica, even they use Krishna Kamal, which is passion flower.
Mm-hmm.
And passion flower is good for high blood pressure. And there is a Hathorn Berry. So we studied, and I wrote a book with one of my friend and student, Dr. David Frawley, and we worked together. And that book is...
I know Dr. Frawley, we've had
So we were working together in Santa Fe. And that book, we have explained Ayurvedic herbs and native Indian American herb. And they have incredible healing power. But we study them through Ayurvedic basic principles of rasa, virya, vipak and prabhav. And that book is very popular now here.
Mm-hmm.
So male and female energy, Shiva Shakti, Purush Prakruti, Yin Yang, Ida Pingala, it is there in the plant.
So how evolved is this herbal treatments in among the Navajo people, for example?
Uh-huh.
How evolved is their treatments of herbal?
Yeah, they, these are Navajo people, they do the pestle and mortar and they collect the herb and they grind it and make a decoction, make a juice or make a tea, herbal tea. But they have very spiritual ceremony and they make a fire ceremony and they bring the herb. And they use the herb, so their approach is very spiritual. And along the same line, there is a great spirituality in Ayurveda also.
Sattva, because they are calling that they're calling their whatever, I don't know, religious or spiritual leaders as medicine men.
Yeah, medicine
so
man.
I'm trying to understand
Navajo medicine
how far
man.
Is the medicine going?
Yeah, medicine man, they are doing that work. And in a group healing they are doing also, in a tent, they call TB, and they make a fire ceremony. And the medicine man comes, there is a pipe ceremony, they smoke some herbs, and they get intoxicated. It is like peyote, something like that. And it is so spiritual, but then it becomes very obscure because they don't have the logic how it works. And Ayurveda has a logic, plus Ayurveda has Satvam, Atma, Shariranja, both.
No, Ayurveda is from a tropical nation,
yeah,
tropical land where there are hundreds of herbs.
Herbs are
here
there.
It's a very meager
limited.
What's available.
Yeah, yeah.
So that's why I know they have that spiritual side, hallucinogenic side, all that.
Mm-hmm.
But in terms of actual medicine, how many herbs are there? Is it a reasonably substantial?
And you are right, because in India we have 3,000, more than that. Here maybe a couple of hundred herbs. The herbs here are limited, but we have plenty of herbs. Even Trifala is such a great herb, it cannot grow here. Some herbs there. Trifala is becoming worldwide wonderful herb, and it is the best for balancing vata, harita ki controls vata, amala ki pitta, bibhida ki kapha. So this Trifala itself is a rasayan, and Trifala itself is an antioxidant enzyme. It removes free radical and it gives longevity of life. So it is a rasayanam. So there are that much rasayana herbs may not be here.
No, they're definitely not there.
No,
except in a tropical nation.
In a tropical nation, right.
It is not available. Even among tropical climates, probably nowhere else there are as many herbs as there are in India. Because
correct. We have
for whatever reason.
Uh-huh.
I mean, I have not found a logical or a scientific reason for this. But a handful of soil in southern India has over 10,000 species.
Wow.
Of microbes and other things in a handful of soil.
Amazing.
Nowhere else on the planet it is like that. Why it is like that, what made it that way, I don't think anybody has made a study as to why it is so, but the fact is it is so.
It is so, right.
So that much microorganism naturally produces that much variety of life. The people have forgotten that how we are is very related to the number of plant life, the variety of plant life there is, variety of animal life, the variety of insect, worm life, and microbes that are around us, how rich it is.
Right.
That's how rich our life is, and
correct,
that's how evolved and complex and sophisticated our life becomes. That's completely forgotten. Everybody is thinking if you eat so much protein, so much vitamin, so much this, everything is going to be okay. You may grow your muscle and be there, but
correct.
All the subtleties of life may disappear from your life.
Mm-hmm.
So in that context, there is very limited amount of herbs here. But I'm sure traditional people somehow should have managed their health with
managed
that.
Managed their health, correct, right. Even in Ayurveda, they use a Shrunga Bhasma, the Harina Shrunga, Shrunga Bhasma. And after certain year, the antler drop out, and that Mruga Shurunga is used for cardiac complication, for disease like arthritis, rheumatism. So then a thought came, why it is so medicinal? So then they realized that the deer eat weeping willow's bark, weeping willow's leaves. And that weeping willow is the natural source of aspirin. Then they found, nowadays they are using aspirin to prevent heart attack. It is a blood thinner, it is an anti-inflammatory. But in Ayurveda, they are using Harina Shrunga or Mruga Shrunga Bhasma. And we can use Mruga Shundra Lepa to the external joint, and that will act as an anti-inflammatory. It will relieve the swelling, pain, and inflammation much under control.
Right now, everywhere videos are going around on the WhatsApp and everything in the social media that every day if you touch a cow, hug a cow, do this, you will get mental and emotional balance.
Absolutely. And that is a special cow about Brahmin cow, which has a hump. And they say that Brahmin cow hump has a Sushumna Nadi that goes to her udder, and that absorbs solar energy. And that ghee prepared out of Indian cow doesn't increase cholesterol, that's the beauty of it. But the Western cow who has a flat back, it is like modified buffalo. Yeah. And this, they have big udder, and that milk from the Western cow is rich in cholesterol, and person can get heart attack. So, the Indian…
I would like to ask you one thing. Right now in Kerala, people are claiming, and we don't know how much of it is true, but I know some of it is true. People have preserved ghee in the earth. They buried it in the earth and kept it for over 100 years. And it seems this ghee has tremendous healing…
Absolutely,
…possibilities. Can you say something?
Yeah. That is called shata. Shata means 100 years. Shata varsha, shata samvatsaram ghritam means the ghee is buried in a clay pot into the soil, 100 years. Because when ghee is staying in the soil for 100 years, that much long time, some molecular changes happen within the ghee. And that ghee is rich in ojas. It is rich in tejas, and it is rich in prana. Because ultimately the pure essence of vata dosha is prana. Pure essence of pitta is tejas, and kapha is ojas. And at cellular level, ojas, tejas, prana, they maintain cellular metabolic activity, cellular intelligence, and flow of communication. Prana is a flow of communication. So at cellular level, ojas, tejas, prana, they are operating and enhancing the cellular life. So this 100-year-old ghee, Purana Ghritam, is the best medicine for eczema, psoriasis. Even if you take internally, it can heal peptic ulcer, ulcerative colitis, IBS, irritable bowel syndrome, many disorders, even autoimmune diseases. This Purana Ghritam is Shrestham Ojas Karam Param. So this promotes ojas.
Is there any parallel in the medical sciences for tejas and ojas? Prana, they're beginning to recognize kind
of. You know, very good question. Prana is your neuroelectrical impulse, your neuroelectricity. But tejas is nothing but certain kind of amino acid. They work at the level of cell membrane, at the level of RNA, DNA. They are tejas. And ojas is the immune system. So, ojas, tejas, prana, these are three important factors. They maintain the life of a single cell. The single cell can live longer. And that's the beauty. But there is no parallel. One thing is there, when liver destroys the old red blood cell, and out of destruction of RBC, the hemoglobin comes out and the heme is separated, and globin part is ojas in the liver. That's why doctor give gamma globulin shot to prevent hepatitis. So that globulin is a very special protein, maybe resembling to the ojas. Tejas is amino acid, liver enzyme, because liver is a seat of 5 bhutagni. Every ether, air, fire, water, earth has an agni component. Nabasa agni, the agni component of space. Vayavya agni, the agni component of air, which really absorb the gaseous exchange happen because of that. Tejo agni, which is responsible for cellular metabolic activity. And apo agni, which maintain plasma serum. And Parthiva Agni is a mineral, calcium, magnesium, zinc. So, exactly when we study modern medicine and Ayurveda concurrently and inherently, then we will understand which part is prana, which part is tejas, and which part is ojas.
In the yogic sciences, generally, ojas is seen as a non-physical dimension of energy. If you… because everything physical has come from the non-physical. If you create a cocoon of non-physical dimension of energy, cocoon does not mean like this.
Right.
On the cellular level, every cell has a little bit of non-physical dimension.
Correct.
A wrap around itself. That cell will continuously regenerate itself at a pace that is considered miraculous.
Correct.
Well, your recovery from anything, injury or any ailment will be like that. Above all, first of all, you don't get sick enough to be called sick. Depending on how violently you live.
Right.
When I say how violently, See, you're living a nice peaceful life, I live a violent life, I'm on full speed on a motorcycle. So, my life is 7 days of the week, 365 days, there's no day, there's no night. You know, sometimes it's 24 hours work, other days it's 18, 20 hours of work. It's a violent life. But still I have not cancelled a single event because I am not well.
Mm-hmm.
Such a thing has not happened in the last 39 years.
No, so, what you say, very beautiful.
A certain amount of ojas kind of puts you back always. Mm-hmm. It doesn't matter. It's not that I have not been unwell. Well, I caught flu, I caught this, I caught that many times. But no matter what's happening, I can still continue my activity.
Right.
So, if what you said kind of interests me, that ojas is that kind of energy which is not physical in nature.
Right, right.
But we, if you are incubated in that always, if every cell is incubated in that always,
correct.
Your recovery or your ability to be beyond what physical things do to you.
I even say that ojas can be measured on physical level in physical term as ojosar. Then tejas can be measured. Then there is a para ojas and upper ojas. So para is superior. Superior ojas is ashtabindvatmakam param ojam rudisthitaha. So that eight drop, ashtabindvatakam ojas, the eight drop of superfine ojas that comes to the heart and that stimulates pacemaker SA node. Then it stimulates to the AV node and to the bundle of His. All cardiac activity are governed by that superior ojas. Then inferior ojas is Ardha Anjali, which is half pint. And that is circulating throughout the body to maintain immunological response. But there is a Shakti Roop ojas that become aura. So if you do meditation, you are in samadhi, then that your upper ojas become para ojas become aura. And that halo, that aura, is nothing but ojas. But the color of the aura is tejas. And pulsation of aura, vibration of aura is prana. Even at the auric level, ojas, tejas, prana are operating in a subtle shakti form. But in a physical form, ojas, there is ojo prakriti. And Ayurveda says, a person who is very handsome, dynamic, with attractive eyes and very charming personality, when he comes, there is a whole vibration.
I look like a blind man.
Yeah, yeah. So that is called, so you fall into that category. Your prakriti is ojo prakriti. So ojas is a physical thing. Ojas can be psychological thing, which is bliss, joy, happiness. And ojas can be spiritual thing, which is samadhi.
So Ayurveda talks about these aspects, is it?
To some extent. Charak does talk about.
I've always been so engaged with life, I never had the patience to study anything. I'm just absolutely involved with life inside and life outside.
Correct, correct, right.
So I never sat down and made a study of anything. So you must tell us, sir, you spent a lifetime of study.
I think your whole life is a study. Even you are driving motorbike, still you are observing, you are learning. There is no end to the study, no end to the learning. Learning is at every moment. And that is your humbleness. You say, I have no time, but you are always in that process.
So just now, yesterday night, some journalist was asking me, when you're writing, what are you thinking about? Are you doing this, doing that? I said, not just when I'm writing, at any time I'm not thinking about anything. Because this whole, this is a European disease that has caught the whole world, it's a pandemic. That people think human thought is more significant than human attention. Human attention, if it is keen enough, intense enough and sustained, it can open any door in the universe.
Absolutely.
Human thought is just a recycling of what you already know. But somewhere our education systems, borrowed from European systems, has inculcated in everybody that your thought is more important than your attention. Attention to creator's creation is more important to than the nonsense that you make up in your head. But everybody thinks you must be thinking something, then only you're an intelligent person.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I don't think much. That's why my face didn't become long.
Mm-hmm.
With age, people, you know,
mm-hmm.
they lose their joy and they become like this, they think they've become serious about it. Well, I think seriousness is the worst ailment.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's such a joke that you are here just for a few years. Before you, thousands of years people have lived here.
Correct.
When you're gone, maybe the grass will be grateful because it's getting sustenance from you because you're buried underneath.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, everybody will forget in a little bit of time and world will be fine without you. But everybody thinks that they have become so important in this universe that they become very serious. Silly little thoughts that they're creating have become bigger than the cosmos.
Mm-hmm.
So, I don't know. For me, life is about attention. How keenly attentive you are mm-hmm. is how much you know of life.
Mm-hmm.
Because everything that needs to be created is already created.
Created.
You just have to be attentive and enjoy the bounty of life that's
Absolutely.
Here. But people are trying to make up their own little world. Their idea of a world is one stupid building that they call as home and so much bank balance and
mm-hmm.
Four wheels parked in front of their house which is shinier than the neighbor's
mm-hmm.
wheels.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, this is their idea of creation.
Correct.
When there is a magnificent creation all over.
mm-hmm.
So this creation of my job, my family, my this keeps them busy and away from the Creator's creation, which is the worst thing that can happen to you.
Absolutely.
So Ayurveda, if it has to become the way of the world, not necessarily in the form that it's come from India, it can happen in so many different ways.
Right.
The fundamentals are right, but how it finds expression in different societies could
Correct.
Be different. If it has to happen, first and foremost thing that needs to happen is that there must be a significance for the creation above your own creation.
Correct. Mm.
Till then, I don't think people will take to Ayurveda. Everybody is looking for a quick fix
mm-hmm.
of some kind.
Correct. And people are doing integration of Ayurveda and acupuncture, Ayurveda and chiropractic, Ayurveda and naturopath, and Ayurveda and allopath. Because Ayurveda is all-inclusive and it doesn't mean that it belongs to India, it can belong to anywhere.
So, sir, you're getting me into trouble.
Hmm.
When I said
mm-hmm.
I said, if, you know, I spoke in the United Nations and I said,
hmm.
if yoga is Hindu, gravity must be Christian. So, even now the people who think they're more Hindu than me are hitting me every day.
Oh,
because they think I gave up yoga. They don't understand if it has to become universal, its identity
right.
has to rise.
Right. You know, when first I came, people think, oh, this is a Hindu medicine. I said, no.
It's okay. Just
yeah.
We'll manage.
Ayurveda is not only Hindu medicine, it is for every religion, it is beyond religion.
See, how can science be a cultural or a religious
right,
identity?
That's
it
the
cannot
limitation,
be.
Yeah.
So goes for Ayurveda, so goes for yoga.
Yeah.
Unless we understand this, then we will keep it cloistered as we have done for thousands of years.
Mm-hmm.
Why Ayurveda has not become the universal system of medicine when it was one of the oldest forms of
medicine
with such complexity, over 100,000 formulations.
Right.
Even modern pharmacopoeia doesn't have 100,000 formulations.
Absolutely, yeah.
But it doesn't become because a constipated approach
mm-hmm.
we've not stepped out and offered. So yesterday some journalist was asking me, because every day they're on social media asking me all kinds of questions. I was standing next to an antique Coca-Cola vending machine, an
mm-hmm.
old one which is not in use right now.
Mm-hmm.
I was in Serona, and I was telling this person, Let's see, if you go to any Indian village, 10 years ago, everybody had heard the word Coca-Cola.
Yeah.
But most people did not know what is yoga. Indian villages, I'm talking about, not Native American, Indian villages, our kind of India, I'm saying. Why is it? Simply because you're constipated in your approach. If we try to push it, you say, oh, you're marketing. If all our programs are free in the villages, but we charge in the cities, oh, your business. Ray, what's wrong with business, I'm saying? Business means somebody needs something and you decide to provide that to them. And if there is no transaction, you can't keep it going. How long will you keep it going?
Correct, right.
It is not about personal profit, it is about making sure the activity is sustainable, isn't it? If I run… I did this first 2.5 years when I thought, after one big experience happened, I wanted to share this. First 2.5 years, I had done business for about 5.5 years by then. First 2.5 years, I spent all my savings and did programs and programs, free programs. Then I ran out of money, then I went through a struggle, what to do, should I collect money, not collect money, because always there's a tradition that, you know, spiritual process, you should not collect money. Then I saw when the fools come to a program without money, they're behaving like they've gone to a cheap cinema. Halfway through, they want to get up, go out, smoke and come back. The moment you charge them, they sit there.
Then it has a value.
Yeah. See, an unfortunate reality. They make a commitment, I will be here for these 10 days or whatever. But their word has no value. Correct. The moment they pay even 5,000 rupees, they will sit there.
They paid
so whose problem is it? Yours or mine? Money is not my problem, it's your problem. So, now we are trying to change that. It is… the most valuable thing should be well marketed.
Correct, right.
Whether it is spirituality, yoga, Ayurveda, Siddha,
absolutely,
it must be well marketed, presented in a way that people will appreciate and embrace.
Absolutely.
Not in some archaic way that nobody wants to do it. Your idea of spirituality is, nobody should do it. All right? Some weird thing you want to say, that only some yogi who is in some cave in Himalayas only does yoga, nobody else does it, because you presented it that way.
Correct.
It is very important, it is presented, if it's well presented, you call it marketing. I don't see anything wrong with marketing, it must be marketed.
Right, right.
If that's a word you like, we will use that word, yes, let's market it well, let's sell it well. I never think in my mind of selling anything. But now everybody is saying, oh, this is market, this is business. No, I'm particularly consciously using the word sell. Yes, I will sell yoga.
Correct.
It's up to you. They're selling Coca-Cola also, carbon dioxide
correct,
they're
correct,
selling.
Correct.
You want to buy that or you want to buy this, make up your mind because
make
your
up.
Market is in your head. Correct. What can I do? The only place that you go to is a marketplace. Do you go to any other place? Hello? The only place people want to go to is a marketplace, isn't it?
Marketplace, right. Shopping.
Yes. So if that is the only place you go, that is the only place I can also be, unfortunately. But my mind is not market. But I'm okay, whichever way it works in the world, I'm all right with it. Because
right.
I live in the times that I live.
Absolutely.
I don't live at another time and be impractical about it. You know, people… Like one day I'm in Chennai, I had to speak in some conference, he's in a hotel and somebody is driving and this man is a very civilized driver, he's unfit to be in Chennai, I'm saying. He's driving slowly behind somebody, I said, just stop it. I made him get down, I got into the driver's seat and I did some aggressive driving. Went there because I made this commitment, I will be never late to any event. Then now, after this some terror attacks and things, in every hotel in India, there is a security check at the gate. It's a meaningless nonsense most of the time. They're just thinking the terrorist will get scared. There is just one tiny little barrier gate. If I have bombs loaded in my car, I will drive through the damn gate anyway, all right? That guy doesn't have a gun, that guy is not standing with a bazooka to stop me, nothing. He's just standing with one mirror and one whistle. What is he going to stop a terrorist? Because it's a law, they've all put up two guys there. So one car went and the gate was up and I burst through that because I'm going to be late. They all started whistling. I went and parked there, got out of the car, ran into the hotel. I was there on time, I finished my conference and I came out after an hour. Some journalists were there when I ran in. The way I blasted into the… I entered the portico maybe at 50-60 kilometers per hour. Then when I came out, this guy is asking, in ancient times, yogis used to walk. You drive your own car, what kind of a yogi are you? Then I said, you idiot, in ancient times, everybody was walking. Not just yogis. I'm saying you have this kind of things, if I must come walking, I must from Coimbatore to Chennai, if I come walking, I become a yogi. No, I become a walker.
Yeah.
I mean, these kind of restrictions we put on ourselves and not reaching valuable sciences to the world, and we're losing it.
Losing it, yeah.
It's time Ayurveda, yoga, all these very precious sciences must reach the maximum number of people.
Correct.
It's a very good thing that our Prime Minister pushed for it and now International Yoga Day has been declared. It is not going to achieve everything that we want, mm-hmm. but at least it's in the consciousness of the world. Correct. That yoga is legal.
Absolutely. In this group, Ayur Prana, Mitesh Bhai, come on, yeah. And Sneha Ben, they have so much dedication, so much love. And they think like you, they think that we should bring Ayurveda to the front so that the whole world will listen to it. So this is a quite a work, it's a big team work. And as you say, this is an inspiration coming from your heart. And they're already doing this work. Thank you, give them big hand, it's amazing. Mm-hmm.
It's good. Is New Mexico made marijuana legal? Not yet.
I have no idea. Is it?
No.
No, not yet.
So I'm saying marijuana, alcohol became legal, marijuana became legal, cocaine will become legal.
Mm-hmm.
Time we make yoga and Ayurveda legal. Thank you, sir. I don't want to take too much of your time.
Yeah. Thank you.